Ultimo Press and Wave Sound Audiobooks present an unabridged recording of The God of No Good by Sita Walker, narrated by Shabana Azeez. The dedication reads, "For my daughter and my sons." 2011, Brisbane. I'm in a coffee shop / bookstore in Stone's Corner when my husband tells me he doesn't want to be married to me anymore. We are drinking cafe lattes, and I have just taken a bite out of a vanilla custard slice. There is icing sugar on my face. This would not be surprising if we had been fighting or arguing, but since we had just decided to go out for a coffee on a Sunday morning because his mother was free to look after the kids, to somewhere as innocuous as Stone's Corner, I'm fairly taken aback by the presentation of divorce papers. It feels like going on a cruise and being told, "Actually, you're being deported. I hope you've packed everything you own." I stifle a giggle and wipe the icing sugar from my lips. Oh, he's serious. We didn't get divorced that Sunday morning. We didn't even get divorced the next time Bohan pulled out the papers. We waited until we were 15 years in, with 3 small children, which is, of course, the ideal time to split up. Fortunately, this was not the first relationship of mine that had ended. I'd already experienced a much more traumatic breakup in the years leading up to this moment. I'd left God. To be fair, Bohan left God first. He left God like Noel Gallagher left Oasis. He peeled religion off like a pair of too tight jeans and tossed it away. He boldly announced to me, his family, his community, and his children, that he had lost his faith. Leaving one's religion shockingly and publicly isn't the sort of thing that most people who have been brought up in intensely faithful homes do, though, in hindsight, it seems on brand for Bohan. I should have seen the yellow envelope, and the latte, coming. This is not a book about divorce. It's not a book about God, either. You might think this is a book about goodness and what it means to be a good person, but it isn't. Like everything else, this is about love. When I left God, I had nothing of Bohan's certitude or courage. My breakup with the Almighty was more like a French exit. I stealthily took tiny pieces of God out of my life, one by one, under cover of darkness. And nobody, not even God, noticed I was gone. Well, not nobody. 9 months ago. I slip a cigarette and a lighter into my pocket and sneak out the front gate, into the cul-de-sac. I make my way into the grassy laneway that leads to the bus stop and walk halfway down it before lighting up and taking a deep drag. Tarragindi, the treed suburb where we live on the south side of Brisbane, is blooming and ripe with the promise of summer. There has been so much November rain that the air is beginning to hold water underneath its skin. The grass in the lane is lush and thick under my feet, and the fence of the yard running parallel is overflowing with passion fruit vines and grapevines and leafy shrubs. Behind the fence, a few chooks are scratching about. City chooks, pecking at bok choy stumps and multigrain bread and tea bags. They don't flutter when I pass. The house at the end of the lane is a 2-story cement and chrome box, with glass surrounding the pool and a postmodern marble statue devoid of imagination in the entryway. It's the type of place where a man in a Ralph Lauren shirt slaps his wife around and cries about it later, buying her bottles of Veuve Clicquot to make up for her bruises. The next day, they call each other baby and eat muesli and fat-free yogurt for breakfast, and she takes the day off work. Their kids go to a Catholic primary school, but they've never been to church. He never means to hurt her. Doesn't he show her how much he loves her with everything he gives her? This house? The yard and cars, the magnolia tree he planted for her against the fence. It's an enormous tree, as beautiful as the house is ugly. It spills over into the lane, trying to escape. With the dart dangling from my lips, I reach up and pull down a large branch. I pluck the most extraordinary magnolia bloom from the tree and inhale its thick perfume. The scent gives me an urge to sit down in the grass with my flower and my cigarette and take my shoes off. But that would be weird, so I walk slowly back down the lane, taking gentle drags, watching to make sure the kids haven't suddenly decided to ride their bikes down the lane. From the chook and vine house on my right, I hear some gentle rustling, and a gentleman emerges, secateurs in hand. "Hi," I say, surprised. "Sorry about the smoke, I'm just hiding from my kids."
"It's no problem."
He smiles. He's tall and imposing, with a large mustache. He looks about 75, but could be older. He has a weather-worn, intelligent face, and a t-shirt that says, "From little things, big things grow." Something in his demeanor makes me think he's European. An elegance, perhaps. He looks like Stalin. My kids think one cigarette will kill me. They're very judgmental about smoking.
Phil, that's human nature. To judge.
Definitely European. A slight accent gives it away. I suppose so. I nod.
Forget about it and have another. I don't mind.
He nods towards the bloom in my hand.
You want to steal one of my flowers too?
Yes, I'd love that, I say, grinning. It feels like I've known him for a long time. He cuts a delicate pink flower from the shrub at his feet and a few orange marigolds from another.
You live down the lane?
He asks, and passes the flowers over the fence. Yes, I live next door to Peter and Judy.
You're the girl with the Indian name?
Ever since I started school, I've been the girl with the Indian name. It's because I don't look brown. I look white. Some people think I'm Spanish or Greek. My mother isn't actually Indian, but she isn't really Iranian either. She's Parsi. They're a hybrid, countryless race of people who nobody in Australia has ever heard of. Zoroastrians who fled Iran in the 8th century to avoid religious persecution. They set sail for India and have been there ever since, marrying Indians and other Iranians and each other. Mostly I tell people, my mother grew up in India, which could imply that she was either the daughter of the British Raj or a Chaiwala from Calcutta. Either way, it usually ends the questioning. Yes, it's Sita. My mother grew up in India.
I'm Joseph, Sita. Nice to meet you. Is your mother Indian?
No, she's Parsi.
Oh, so you're Zoroastrian.
My eyebrows raise themselves involuntarily. No, actually. My mother is a Baha'i. It's a religion.
I know what it is. Baha'is believe in one God. Unity of religions, yes?
That's the one.
Yep.
I'm taken aback.
Are you a Baha'i?
He asks, genuinely interested, pruning the mock orange. I'm not sure what I am. He gives a gentle chuckle. Thank you for these. They're lovely, I say by way of exit, stubbing my dart on a steel fence post and turning to leave with my marigolds.
You must be in love. Yes, Sita?
I turn back in surprise, wondering if I've heard correctly. Even more astonishing is the answer that falls out of my mouth. I think I might be.
Ah.
He shakes his head.
Nobody thinks they're in love. You're either in love, or you're not in love.
Maybe he's German. The way he says love sounds a little bit like luff. The way he's questioning me is definitely Germanic. I am in love, Joseph, I say, with a resignation the statement doesn't really deserve. He nods and overturns a restaurant-grade mayonnaise bucket filled with weeds, lowering himself down slowly in the way of tall older men who are still fit but just a little swollen in the joints. I offer him a cigarette through the wire fence and take another one myself, sitting down cross-legged in the grassy laneway.
So what's the problem then?
He asks, slipping the dart between his lips and cupping the lighter flame with a brown, leafy hand.
What is it about me that makes you think I'm in love?
I know you don't have a husband, because Judy told me and Rupi when she came over to play cards last week, and I've never seen you smoking in the lane before, so something is making you feel stressed or nervous. Excited, perhaps. But mostly, it's the way you're holding the flowers, like a lover would.
I laugh at this absurd detective work, mostly because of its accuracy. Perhaps I just like flowers, I reply.
What's the problem with being in love?
He persists, like a border collie with a tennis ball. I don't want to be in love, Joseph, I say, sassing him just a bit, this old man I've never met. He likes it. When I'm old, I hope young men sass me while I'm pruning my roses. He grins, surrendering. We sit in companionable silence for a few minutes. Joseph finishes his smoke, puts it out in the grass, stands up with a little groan, and lays the butt neatly on the mayonnaise bucket. Picking up the secateurs, he rubs his elbow and announces, impressed,
I've never met a girl who didn't want to be in love.
I'm too old to be a girl, I say, Mona Lisa smile. I can't resist a man who is impressed by me, even if he is older than God. I love male approval. It's one of my worst qualities. He deftly pulls some stray leaves and twigs from the hedge and tosses them on the pile of weeds.
You're playing hide and seek in the laneway and stealing flowers, yes?
He says with a smile.
You look like a girl to me.
I stand up and brush myself off, laughing.
I haven't fallen in love for a long time,
he says, pruning the grapevine now.
I love my wife. We have been married 40 years. It's a different love now. I don't think I can remember what it was like to fall in love.
I think of the way it felt to hold him while he wept. The way I wake up and want to do something for him. Anything. To worry about him. To urge him to eat more greens. To reach over in the dark in the middle of the night and feel his chest rise and fall. I think about how he sends me novels to read and play after play. Miller, Stoppard, Williams, Christopher. He's dug a moat around me, and now he's filling it with words. Protecting me with the only shield he has. Stories. A river of love and pain and bliss and pride and sorrow and mercy and courage and laughter and wisdom and bold vengeance and surprising hate. I think of how loving him makes me want to be his slave and his ruler both at once. How I see him as a boy and as a man, one inside the other like a Russian doll. And I am the same, a girl and a woman at once in his arms. I think of how I don't want any of it. Love and pain are two fangs of the same snake. You cannot be pierced by one without also being poisoned by the other. This is why the fearful can never truly love. They can't bear the pain. I look at Joseph and smile gently. Anyone can fall in love, but not everyone can stay in love. 40 years is a long time. I'm sure you and Rupi know love better than I do. 1989. Toowoomba. I'm 8 years old, and every night I pray for God to make me good. I want so desperately to be good. My mother, Fari, is big on good. She is not interested in whether I can read or write, whether I know how to dance or how to cook or how to play the piano. She is interested in whether or not I am on good terms with the Almighty. Do I pray every morning and every night? Do I bring myself to account each day? Am I kind? Do I treat others how I would like to be treated? Fari is always saying, you must be kind to all people and love them with a pure spirit. To live the life is to be no cause of grief to anyone. I fear I cause daily grief to many. I dabble in a variety of sins, the least of which is my sharp tongue. To wit, Fari likes to gently remind me that we should never allow ourselves to speak one unkind word about another. even though that other be our enemy. Good people don't backbite or gossip, and they always tell the truth. Just this week I called one of the neighborhood kids a pig bird behind her back because I knew it would make the others laugh. Her mum found out and told Fari and my father, John. Their disappointment in me as I sat in front of them in the formal lounge was almost as torturous as their instruction to hand-deliver a written letter of apology to her and her parents. I did it, shaking like a little pig bird. Mr. Barrett, my year three teacher, doesn't make good easy either. He is a skinny man with a red face who wears pressed shorts and long socks and shakes the boys by the shoulders when they make him angry. He never shakes girls. Instead, he makes us wait in the hallway for the principal to walk past. I usually crawl into the port racks and hide among the backpacks, forgotten swimming bags and moldy bananas in the hope that our principal, Mr. Guilfoyle, won't see me. He always does. I have at least 17 vengeful thoughts about Mr. Barrett every day, which is disappointing because good people keep their thoughts and deeds pure. My primary sin is talking in his class. Also messiness. Also daydreaming. Oh, and everyone, especially my dad, thinks I'm too bossy. A flaw I plan to address through hope and prayer. My dad is a very good man. Extraordinarily principled. He never backbites or swears. He doesn't drink or smoke or gamble, not even a lotto ticket. He's clean and tidy. He hangs the towels on the line without wasting pegs. He reads improving books and alphabetizes our bookshelves, and we have a lot of books. My eldest sister, Lisa, is Dad's favorite, even though he would never admit to having one. She's married to a good man, and even though she is beautiful and vain and spends far too much time in the bathroom, she's good too. My brother, Jamal, is always being scolded for kicking balls in the house and forgetting to mow the lawn. But Fari and my grandma, Dolly, love him like a god. A Raja. He must be good. But nobody, nobody, is as good as Rani. Rani is Fari's favorite, even though she would never admit to having one. They move with the same spirit, laughing at the same jokes, seeing the world in the same colors. They even look the same. Black hair, olive skin, shiny eyes that crinkle at the corners. A book and its binding. Rani is a school prefect. They gave her a gold badge to mark her goodness. Her side of our shared room is neat and tidy. She keeps a prayer book by her bed, and under her pillow is a diary filled with messages, doodles, and folded paper frogs and love hearts from her friends. Whenever the phone rings, it's for her. She wears the coolest clothes and pink frosty lipstick on her mouth, and Fari never tells her she can't. She's the only one Jamal treats with reverence. When I can't sleep, she lets me hug her black teddy, Sooty, and she says I can have her red-lined bike when she finishes school at the end of the year. She taught me how to use a pencil to fix a cassette when the tape spills out, and how to record songs off the radio so I can listen to them whenever I want. Sometimes she pulls my long hair too hard when she's folding it into plaits. Go softer! Stay still. Don't you want to look like Pippi Longstocking? Pippolotta Delicatessa Window Shade Mackerel Mint Ephraim's daughter, Longstocking, is my hero. I spend most school afternoons perched on top of our broken tennis shed, pretending to be her. Some toy or other strapped to my shoulder like Mr. Nilsson, Pippi's monkey. I like to wear shirt dresses, knee socks, and my hair in plaits, just like her. I figure if being good doesn't work out, piracy is my only alternative. Rani's boyfriend, Ashley, is a broad-shouldered giant with a golden, curly mullet. He never calls me Sita the Girl or Snotface like Jamal's friends do. He calls me Cutie and watches Scooby-Doo with me, sharing his chips. Whenever he calls Fari Mrs. Walker, she smiles and says coyly, Ashley, don't you know my name? Oh, sorry, it's Queen Walker, isn't it? he replies with a little bow, and Fari laughs and offers him biscuits or cake or whatever is in her hands, and he eats it in one bite. I see her smile at him when he's not looking. When Ashley is in our room, Rani shuts the door and shuts me out. I'll give you 20 cents if you go away. Make it 50. I take her money and lie on the floor of the hallway, ear to the carpet, spying under the door, trying to hear what's being said over you two's All I Want Is You. Sometimes I flick little balls of paper under, trying to hit their ankles. Sometimes Ashley flings the door open and chases me like a bear, or Rani opens the door and hisses, "Go away, or I'm never doing your hair again." Sometimes their feet disappear, and I wonder where they went. I'm the last of the Walkers. The baby, by almost a decade. Jamal likes to refer to me as the accident, but my dad always corrects him. He says I was a pleasant surprise. We live on Bridge Street in a big country house with wooden walls, a tin sheet roof, and a long hallway down the middle, sprouting bedrooms. The ceilings are high and filled with light, and the windows big enough for two kids to climb in at the same time. There's an outhouse lined with spiders, peeling linoleum on the kitchen floor, and back steps that need painting. The house grumbles and tilts, but Bridge Street is simply the most wonderful place on earth. There's never a room without somebody in it, and God lives in the walls. Our town, Toowoomba, is built in a crater bowl and surrounded by mountain ranges. It's so high up that in the morning the fog cuts the roofs off houses, and at night the moon seems close enough to hold. Mr. Barrett taught me that before it was colonized, Toowoomba was a swamp. The settlers came and drove out the people of the swamp. Then they drained and pummeled the fleshy ground into submission. They cleared and tilled fields and fenced paddocks. They built houses and churches and schools. The water flowing into the bowl from the sky and the mountains was channeled by man-made culverts and streams, a series of creeks and waterways that led it through the hills and into the west. When summer turns to autumn, the wind blows over the mountains and fills the bowl, swirling and sweeping leaves into little tornadoes. It's the kind of wind that whips the cheeks of children red and puts young men in a dangerous mood. Toowoomba is a place where flowers grow through the cracks in the pavement. They say it's the swamp trying to push its way back to the surface. They say that, but what they mean is, eventually, all deeply buried things find their way up through the cracks. The last time I saw my sister Rani, she was riding the red line down the side of our house, and I was running after her, asking for a turn. That summer, the summer of 89, when Rani and Ashley died, the whole town wept. The creeks and streams ran high with it, flowing and gushing into the culverts and through the mountains and down into the valley where my sister and Ashley and three other kids were found, unconscious in a rolled car. And the wind? The wind brought my aunts to Bridge Street. Auntie Erie cooked for days, weeping as she stirred and seasoned, red-faced and sweating at the stove. Chicken and lamb curries, brown lentil soup with generous handfuls of coriander and mint, yellow lentil spiced dal, her special red macaroni cheese, creamy inside and golden on top. Food piled up in our kitchen like we were catering a Maharashtrian wedding. Auntie Mona prayed. She prayed over everyone. She took us out into the garden and cuddled us close to her Cotton Island caftan and prayed and prayed and prayed. The constant sound of her murmuring and chanting became background noise, like the sound of test cricket over the summer. Auntie Mary walked up and down the length of our home like a headmistress. She cleaned and tidied efficiently and without rest. She welcomed guests. She told people when to leave and when to go to bed. She didn't sleep. She didn't smile. She made beds
and hung out sheets and towels, and watched over us all like a wolf. She watched my dad especially well. Watched and waited. My grandmother Dolly hovered over her four daughters and followed me wherever I went. I wore a pink dress to the funeral, my ankles blistering in white court shoes, my neck sweating under my loose hair. At the gravesite, my father read the prayer for the dead, and Mehri held me on her lap, her scarlet sari silken under my dangling legs. Leaning back and putting my lips to her ear, I whispered, "Auntie, my shoes hurt."
"Take them off. Put your feet on the grass, it's okay,"
she said, her voice strong, her chest tight. I took off the shoes. The grass that was soon to cover my sister felt cool and fresh under my hot feet. Mary turned me to face her.
"We have to be strong, Sitaku. Like this,"
she said in a low voice, balling her fist tightly and holding it next to her heart. I put my fist up to my chest and squeezed it tight, looking into her dark eyes.
"Good,"
she said.
"You're a good girl."
A light went out that day, and I didn't cry at all. 1952, Panchgani. Fari hitches up the woolen skirt of her navy blue uniform and tucks it into her underpants, her fingers and mouth purple with mulberry juice. Up she goes, one branch at a time, climbing through the purpley green haze to the top of the tree, snatching the choicest berries on the way up. The tree is high on a plateau, but here on the world's hilltop, everything is high. When she reaches the peak, sitting on the sturdiest brackened branch she can find, she parts the greenery, snaps a few small stalks off, and picks away the berries before letting them drop to the ground. She gazes out at the valley, her brown eyes hazel in the glow. Panchgani sits in the middle of five hills in the Sahyadri mountain ranges in Maharashtra, a jewel in the emerald ring of India. The river Krishna flows like an open serpent through the foothills of the mountains. Fari watches it turn golden and mauve in the setting sun as she pops sweet balls of juice into her mouth and wipes the purple dribble away with the back of her hand. It drips down into the cuff of her white uniform sleeve, and her bare feet swing in the way only a little girl's can. Her toes like brown buttons. She should be back at school for prep and prayers, but she knows this evening he will come. She knows it in her heart. She knows it like she knows how she will convince Shivani Khanum not to send her to Nargis Khanum for a beating and scolding tonight. It doesn't matter anyway, because seeing him will be worth 10 beatings. Seeing him will be something to tell Namat and Eerie. Something extraordinary. She waits and watches, shifting slightly on her branch, but not disturbing the leaves. Once, Matram Shivani Khanum told her that she would not punish her for spoiling her best going out dress if she pulled 100 grey hairs from her head. Fari said yes, knowing the task would be impossible. Khanum didn't have many greys, and she was as vain as a Raja's peacock. Slyly, Fari pulled out one grey hair and showed it to Shivani. Then, she proceeded to pull out black hairs and pass them backhanded to her sister Eerie, all the while showing Khanum the same one grey hair and making warm comments about her beauty, her youth, and her long black locks. Not only did she escape a beating, but Shivani washed her tea-stained going-out dress herself and brought it back pressed. The valley is painted in post-monsoon mixed greens. Indian green, hothouse green, forest and lime and jade. The air is mossy and fresh, and the insects buzz. Fari lets a beetle crawl onto the back of her hand.
"Hello, little bug. Have you seen him? Where is he?"
she whispers, stroking orange wings with her blackened finger. A shimmer and the beetle flies away. Fari's eyes follow it to the base of the tree. She sees a black shadow pass underneath, and her body turns to ice. It is him. The panther strides out from under the tree, making its way down the hillside. Slowly, perfectly, a ballet of black. Fari holds her breath and sits like a stone, watching his muscular shoulders roll his velvety body as he strides through the long grass and strawberry vines, stalking like a pool of hot tar towards little copse of trees. Here, he pauses, puts his nose to the ground and stills, taking in a scent. Suddenly, his head is turned back and lifted upwards, pointing directly at the mulberry tree. Fari can swear he is looking right at her with his yellow cat eyes. For a second, they are joined like lovers in the gloaming. She closes her eyes quickly, not to allow him inside her, not to let him stalk back and scale the tree and eat her whole, bones and all. The crunch of her little body would be like a pappardom in his slick jaws. Trembling, eyes vice-closed, she grips the branch of the tree and whispers her magic prayer, over and over.
Oh God, guide me, protect me, make of me a shining lamp and a brilliant star. Oh God, guide me, protect me, make of me a shining lamp and a brilliant star. Oh God, guide me, protect me, make of me a shining lamp and a brilliant star.
When she opens her eyes, the valley is empty. She is alone. 12 months ago. At 5 p.m, my phone pings. Fingerprint recognition isn't working. I swipe up and tap in my passcode. I click into the little yellow hive icon. It's him.
Been a little held up. Can we say 5:15? Sorry. X.
I send the thumbs up emoji, hoping this isn't a man who is always late to everything. The pub is quiet, and I've chosen a high table close to the bar under some warm brass lamps. I feel self-conscious, like I should have tied my hair back, even though my outfit is understated. Jeans, tan boots, and a grey cable knit. My earrings are silver horses, dangling. My hair is long and shiny, and I've spritzed it with perfume so that it smells like yellow freesia and rose. It's falling across my face. I look for a hair tie in my clutch.
Ping.
Thank you. Was just coordinating a FaceTime with my little dude.
This is better. Another thumbs up emoji, because I'm trying to be aloof and cool. The thumbs up says, I'm busy and caught up in something other than you. I'm in demand. I've got things going on. I'm above your lateness.
I'm not. I'm kicking myself for getting here first. My insides are moths, bumping into a fluorescent tube, and I can't find a hair tie. A drink.
Brisbane Brewing is a relaxed microbrewery in the city's bohemian West End. Steel vats line the walls. They're all about beer, but I order a dry Prosecco. The Foo Fighters are playing just loud enough for me to have to raise my voice slightly to order. Should I be bold and buy him a beer so that it's on the table when he arrives? What kind of message does that send? That I'm thoughtful and cool? Or overeager? What if he doesn't want beer? What if he's vegetarian? What do I even mean by that? No beer. The barman looks at me as if he knows I'm here to meet someone, and I feel myself go red in the face. I take a sip of bubbles as I walk back to my stool. Tangy and crisp. Like a Granny Smith. I remember the first drink I ever had. I was 28 and had just weaned my second baby off my breast. Since Borhan's grand exodus from faith and followership, he had been having some sort of belated and extended O-week, reading Nietzsche, watching Richard Feynman talks about particle physics, and drinking Glenfiddich's Scotch whiskey. For us, alcohol was strictly forbidden. It was against our religion. It weakened the mind and the spirit and tarnished the purity of the drinker. Good, faithful,
transcendent people, did not drink. All throughout high school and university, I never touched a drop, not even in a risotto or a plum pudding. But with two small children and a husband experiencing a hedonistic renaissance, something came over me. I decided that God and I needed a little space. So, at the end of a blustery afternoon wrangling small children, I stood at my kitchen bench, spilling over with sippy cups, plastic spoons, and mashed apple, and I poured myself my maiden glass of red wine. The weight of goodness slipped away as I tentatively put the cup to my lips, like some sort of reverse communion. It was revolting. I spat it out into the sink. But it didn't matter. I felt exhilarated, like I'd made a choice for myself, like I'd made my very own mistake. Ping. I'll be there anon. The actor speaks in prose. I feel an excited tingle running down from my throat to my stomach, fizzing together with the bubbles of my Prosecco. I imagine him quoting Much Ado About Nothing to me, while he pours red wine into bolognese in the nook kitchen of our bohemian cottage in West End. I imagine his book collection, vast, his taste in music, eclectic, the Dandy Warhols and Johnny Cash, perhaps, maybe some 90s grunge. I imagine he smokes occasionally, even though his profile said, smokes, never. I imagine he likes to shower in the morning. I imagine he's into blondes, or businesswomen, or yoga instructors, not nerdy brunettes with three kids and neo-existentialist ex-husbands. I adjust my stool so I can see the entrance to the pub and text my best friend, Andy. He's late. Ping. Ugh, actors. It had better be because he was hit by a van. He was on the phone to his kid. Ping. He has kids? How many? How old? No idea. Shit, he's here. I slide my phone under my clutch, take one more sip of the Granny Smith, and stand up to kiss Anthony's gruff cheek for the very first time. His greeting is warm and sincere, with a hint of mannered reserve. He smells good. Fresh. Low-key. He looks like he could be Russell Crowe's younger brother, but with less hair. We exchange pleasantries. I'm feeling awkward, and haven't eased into the interaction with what anyone would call charm. He puts his satchel down on the stool opposite me, and goes to make for the bar, turning back sheepishly.
I took a punt with the whole be there anon thing. Couple Arvo wines. How'd that land?
I grin. It was a first for me. 2016, Brisbane. I crawl under the white doona of my marital bed, in jeans, a t-shirt, and sneakers, and pull it up over my head. I don't think I can do this. I managed to get the kids to school this morning and to call in sick to work, but I'm not sick. I've just lost my will to live. I can smell a sweaty tang on the floral sheets, and I wonder when I last washed them. Under the doona it's warm, and I breathe in my own air as the tears begin to fall down my cheeks, their saltiness mingling with the moisturizer on my face. And then I sob, heaving sobs. Sobs so dramatic my chest begins to hurt. Last night I had the dream again. It's always the same. I'm standing in the kitchen or the lounge, and I'm chewing bubble gum. A big glob of pink, rubbery gum. I decide to spit it out, but it's sticking to my teeth. So I pull at it. I pull, and the gum keeps coming and coming. It's filling up my mouth. It's in my throat. I'm having trouble breathing, but I can't call for help because my mouth is plugged up with gum. Just when I think I've pulled the last bit out, there's more rising up from my esophagus, a never-ending pink goo glob. I have this dream every few months, but last night it was particularly distressing. I woke up and gasped for air. I reach for my phone, still sobbing, scroll down my recent calls and click on Ma. 2 rings and she picks up. 2 hours and she and my dad have driven down the mountain, across the valley, and into Brisbane City. They are at my house. They let themselves in. Dad knocks politely on my open bedroom door and says jovially,
"Is my precious treasure under there somewhere?"
"I'm sorry you had to drive all the way here, Dad," I gurgle from under the covers, before surfacing looking so wretched that my 6'4" father crawls into the bed next to me, his long, broad back leaning up against the headboard, and scoops me up into his arms.
"There, there, dear. We're here now. It's no trouble. What are parents for? We'll sort you out, darling."
My mother is pacing up and down.
"Fari, stop flapping about and make her a cup of tea, will you?"
Mum leans over Dad and kisses my cheek, feels my forehead with her palm and her wrist. She smells of Pond's day cream and turmeric. I feel a calmness hit my belly and start to spread out. A tear falls down my cheek, but she wipes it away.
"Don't worry, baby. Daddy will fix all of it. Just tell him what you need."
She turns on him.
"John, John, you fix it, okay?"
"Okay."
"Like it's done. Sita, where are the kids? Are they all right?"
"They're at school, Ma."
"Darling, tea. Off you go. I'll have one too while you're at it,"
Dad says, with his usual efficacity. He pulls a neatly folded cotton handkerchief from his top pocket and offers it to me. I take it and pat my face dry. While Fari is brewing the tea and washing the pots and pans in my messed up kitchen, I tell my dad that I have so much to do and I don't really know how to do it. I've told Bohan I'm moving out, but I need to find a house to rent. I need to file for divorce. I need to change my surname. I need to sort out the health insurance and the Centrelink and the Medicare. I need to buy a car. He pats my shoulder with his gigantic hand and gives the occasional hum of acknowledgement. I lean into his chest. A noisy miner outside my window is peeping and chirruping to a rhythm. The cat wanders in and jumps up on my bed. Mum comes back with 2 cups of tea, hot, with a dash of milk. Lately, she's been warning me about the dangers of sugar. Last time she was here, she refused to put any more than 1/2 teaspoon into my cup. Dad has been cut off completely. I take a sip, and the tea is sweet.
"Thanks, Ma."
She sits on my other side, and there we are, 3 in a row, with a saucy cat at our feet. Mum takes my free hand and puts it between hers.
"I'm going to say a prayer, baby. You'll see how magic it is. It will fix everything."
I haven't prayed in years, but I nod. Dad slurps his tea and says,
"Your mother will pray, and then I'll call Medicare."
1957. Sydney. John sharpened his pencil and breathed out a sigh.
Latin. What was the point? Enduring French was bad enough, but Latin?
There was simply no rational reason he should have to translate Julius Caesar's account of the Gallic Wars from Latin to English. It had been done. His Trinity Grammar Latin master, Mr. Horrocks, was tall and thin, sharp and pointed. A pencil of a man. He liked to sweep about in his academic gown, conjugating verbs with relish. John fingered his collar and imagined his stick-straight teacher sinking into quicksand. He smiled. John's mind was not on Latin. It was on Muhammad, the only theological stumbling block he encountered with the Baha'i teachings was the question of Muhammad. John's mother, Margaret Jeanette Walker, loved him. She taught him to cook, to sew, to clean and polish floors, to hang out the washing neatly without wasting pegs. She encouraged his studies and always made sure he left the house with a freshly pressed handkerchief in his pocket. She was particular, neat, and meticulous, with a will that could no more be broken or bent than a steel girder on the harbour bridge. Margaret enjoyed spotless floors, a nicely pressed linen frock, and several dry sherries after dinner. She did not enjoy divorcing her husband because he decided to leave the bank, join some hippie communist religion, and spend his time with people whose names she couldn't pronounce. Nor did she enjoy that Baha'i shindig infecting her tall, handsome, well-educated son. It was best, Margaret thought, that John be confirmed in the Anglican Church as soon as possible. John was not so sure. He had secretly read his father's books on the Baha'i faith, hiding them under his mattress or at the back of the linen cupboard. He was taken with it. He could not understand his mother's prejudice, or how this religion of love and unity could be the source of a feud that had ended his parents' marriage. He thought it a sensible religion in every way. There was just the pesky issue of Muhammad. The faith taught that Muhammad was a manifestation of God, just like Jesus Christ or Moses, Buddha, and Krishna. But the schoolboy image John had of Islam was of Muhammad spreading his word by the sword, or lounging in an orgiastic chamber surrounded by 40 wives. Saladin, violently slicing his way through Africa, conquered peoples given the choice of conversion or death. He had to find out more. To buy himself some time and appease his mother, John told her that he would attend all the divinity classes required prior to confirmation, and then make up his mind. He had spent the last week at the school library, nose deep in the Encyclopedia Britannica and Gibbon's History of the Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, the only two places he could find anything written down about Islam. But it was not enough to be really sure about Muhammad. John realized that he needed to read the Quran. The problem was, he couldn't get one. Trinity Grammar didn't have one. The library didn't have one. Perhaps his father had one, but he was selling life insurance in Mudgee, living in a boarding house, and there were only two trains out there per week. It was a real pickle, made worse by his mother pressuring him to commit himself to the Anglican Church forever. In divinity class, John had asked his teacher, the Reverend Michaels, about Islam. Michaels was young and not too bright. He had an air of self-importance in his dog collar. He was not universally liked. "The first thing you need to know about Islam is that Muslims are pagans," said Reverend Michaels. "What is a pagan, sir?" asked John. "A pagan is someone who doesn't believe in God." "Sir, that's an atheist." The class was still. Now he had their attention. "Well, they're heathens then," said Michaels, eyeballing John as though he were a fly in his soup. "Sir, what is a heathen?" asked John, politely. "Heathens are people who don't believe in Jesus Christ." Well, this did not align with the evidence presented in John's research. "Sir, I've been doing a bit of reading about Islam, and I understand that Muslims do believe that Jesus was a prophet of God. They believe that he was the spirit of God, born of the Virgin Mary, and that his word was the word of God." The tips of Michael's ears coloured plum. "Well, they don't believe he is God, do they?" he spat. John was unperturbed. Actually, he was rather enjoying himself. The class hummed in anticipation of his next move. "I've got an uncle who is a minister in the Anglican Church," John said, "who thinks that the Trinity is meant to be taken metaphorically and not literally." This was all too much for Michaels. He marched over to John's desk, rapped on it with his pink knuckles, and said, "Walker, I'll discuss this with you later." When the class was finished and the boys had begun filing out, the Reverend called John over to his desk. "Walker, don't you ever do that again."
"Do what, sir?"
"If you ever, ever do that again, you'll be cut from the athletics team. Do you understand?"
John did. He understood that prejudice was irrational.
Michaels didn't know anything about Islam, and yet he had begun his discussion about it with a prejudicial statement. His mother was the same. She knew nothing about the Baha'i faith, and yet she despised it because of what other people would think. The only thing divinity class had confirmed in John was that ignorance and prejudice were two heads of the same beast. And that beast was pride. John went home to his mother that afternoon and said, "Mum, I know what you want, but I'm not ready to be confirmed or to make any statement of faith just yet." Margaret pursed her lips, pushed a length of tweed cloth through her sewing machine, and didn't say a word. 1963. Pune. Fari sits cross-legged on the divan, worrying her swollen bottom lip with her top teeth.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.